Okay, so now leads us up to our last time salmon, doesn't it?
It certainly does. Yeah. A man we know so well.
Very well. And he's known all around town, but in the best possible way. Please put your hands together for the lovely Dave Brighton!
That's good, I think.
Thank you very much. It's nice to be here. I'm pleased to have won it, actually. It's an honour. So I've got some poems that are longer than 3 minutes, and otherwise I wouldn't be able to say them, would I? I'll do a short one. This is an attempt to sort of communicate what it's like to be in a violent argument. It's called Day Off in Wolverhive on a Wednesday. And for a while at least, I take my leave, and I can smile and I can breathe. And I can fill this bag of bones with air and have no care. Scratched, bit, mocked, and hated. Hated more than words can tell, for words cannot explain the hate that crackles electric in the air between us, prickling our skin and hairs with hate. Words are what was said, a record for the court. They don't convey the way the space bubbles and sucks and storms around us, captures us like shit and litter in the wind, whipped, snapped, flipped out, picked up, thrown about, gasping and howling for breath. Smack, here against the kitchen table. Smack, there against the dirty dishes in the sink. Everything we ever cared for shattered in the dog food on the floor. But for a while at least, I take my leave. Let my love lie in the lay-by, baby love, come lay by me. Let the grass grow on the landfill, where we'll sit beneath the tree. And the hills will rise around us, and the hills will rise around us, and the hills will rise around us, and they'll smile and let us breathe. Thank you. Right, when I'm not doing this, I often... I work in, I run bars and festivals, and little festivals full of hippies. And at the end of each one, everyone says goodbye to their festival family. And they all say they go back to, I don't know, Watford and Tunbridge Wells and wherever they come from. And so they go back to normality, but I think about what's happening in Hastings, and I think, well, I'm not going back to normality, I'm going back to Hastings. And this is about the kind of economy of Hastings and the sort of, you know, how we go away from town to make money and bring it back, or we invite people here, we dress up as fucking pirates and shit like that, and pots about. So it's one part's about the export, one part's about the import, and the other bit's about how that leaves us. It's called Hastings Pure, which is a reference to a class of cocaine. Which is not as good as it's supposed to be, anyway. One, export. We had a memo by text. It wasn't just a post on the Facebook job page, so we knew it was important. Drawing to our attention the company's policy about body odour and bad breath. There have been complaints from other colleagues, customers, and the clients. So, Hastings workers, management will be checking, and if BO or smelly faggy breath is found, it will lead to cancellation of shifts and even termination of employment. We shrug and nod. It's fair enough, really. Whatever. Where we come from, they don't know how we're supposed to smell. It doesn't matter, Dave. It's us and them anyway. Fuck them, and we don't say anything. I've worked here 3 years. I'm going nowhere, mate. He won't sack me. Again. Fuck it anyway. The paramedics and the doctors and the nurse burst into the first aid room. Important and serious talk of real estate, skiing, holidays, boats and currency exchange rates. Sniff, pause, work. You won't know if your armpits smell till Tuesday. Don't even talk to these cunts, Dave, it's us and them. And when I do raise a hand to ask a question, yes, that look does confirm that yes, it's them and us. Please, what? Did I say I could smell the skunk on your sweaty skin? No. So just shut up. If you don't leave town from time to time, you can begin to think we're normal, that it's people who look like they're off the adverts buying chinos and barbecues every weekend who are weird. Then they send you on jobs to the places where the landlords live. You Uttoxeter, St Albans and Tunbridge Wells, and you realise it's us, wet, devilled, sweaty and red, half dead and heavy with smell. And we can't talk shit about skiing and holidays and cars. More of us can talk about cars than can drive cars because a driving licence is pricey. And we have police, camera, action on all night long. Honestly, they do look at us as if we're invisible and not the same. It is a shame, but it's not our problem. Two, import.
Yay!
And even in the what we do well, where we're on safer ground, doing the things they want us to do better than them. The sex and drugs, and the drum and bass, and the buy-to-let ket den, two up, two downs, poncing about in stupid fucking giant, Morris man, mackerel, crack horde, horny pirate maid dressers, beside the sea, song cycle, trick bicycle, psychogeography, art break, Airbnb, gunpowder puff, fuck parade, bless us. Even and especially there, we're forever fucking up, tripping over, falling out, ripping off, making up and making eyes, telling tales and lies, and having awkward, rictus conversations that don't work until you realise that neither of you still works at the pub, bar, venue, phenomenon that you'd nailed your identity to last month, which is actually a really good thing, and we're still good friends, learned loads, still hope it goes well. Hey, you'll still see me there, but it'll be better because I'll be able to chat with you because I won't be working, because I don't know if I'll work again in this town. This isn't me saying this. Three, geography. From the north, where the surrounding villages are laid, you look south to a dark ridge that's always in shade. The ridge has been the border of the town since before King Offa and the English invaded in 771. Crested by a brocade of black treetops, spiked by aerial broadcast masts and crematoria, and crenellated by the tops of rows of roofs of streets and hedges and the trailer parks and container depots that line our highland edges. There are families in those valleys and the surrounding country whose children are forbidden to cross our border because drink, drugs, insanity, dogs and teen sex babies and lousy, lousy luck and riot and disorder. This ridge rises dark around the beating heart of our pulsing poundland Mordor of Mandy and Gatter, kebab shops and restaurants, bars, clubs, pubs, the screams of the seagulls and all the girls and all the boys and the basement base bedrooms of your sons and your daughters, eyes, cheeks, lips, raw in the bright white light of the night. Oh, I wish I hadn't come here. I must go home. No problem. Love you, brother. Peace go with you. And all we know right now is how to go, tripping down the streets, off our tits and on our feet, on our hands and on our knees, eyes rushing back in our heads, grinning as quick as light through the night to the secret sofa surfaces of home. And when I speak of solidarity, you say, what the fuck did we expect? I never once came into work on time, so I still have my self-respect. I said I would have sacked me if I was in his shoes. Don't tell me I'm a loser when I had nothing to lose. It's all good. But brother, I respect what you do. Just chill the fuck up. It'll be okay, yeah? Solidarity, my friend. I love you till the end. Hastings Pure. It'll be what it is.
How
much more time?
We've got loads of time.
Okay, cool.
Well,
I've got two more poems in.
We love you, Dave!
Okay. Alright, this one, I don't know what it's about, but it's a poem. It's called I Take to the Streets in the Morning, Tomorrow I Take to the Streets. I won't write. I won't write anything. That's what you wrote. When I met you first, years ago, I was caught by the throat. Unusually silent, I listened and time snapped shut, hushed when you spoke. They took first your hands and they put them apart on the wall, Then they looked at your life, took your words, they looked at them all. I won't say anything, you told them. Defiant, you shut with a choke. How did you find the strength for silence? You had always seemed weak. Maybe what happened, you told me once where you seldom speak, how surviving the first of your days, accused and unwanted, alone, as a child you were taught to be ashamed. You lay and learned in the night, growing to love your shame, how it gave you the courage to fight. Anyway, I only have pride, and I'm lazy, drinking coffee, holding my phone. Every once in a while, I find my eyes sliding towards your last space, and I can't look. The cat's called, scratched. They wanted to follow your trace. I'll have another cup of coffee, a wash, dress, and then maybe I'll write. It is a great, beautiful morning. The window lights and finally I break, at least enough to want the streets to swagger and roll in your wake. I'm going to walk around whistling at women, drinking whiskey and look for a fight. I said I like danger, and moved by my words and the thought of my death, I forgot to listen as you folded the note in your pocket and drew in your breath. I thought I'd like danger, but I must stick it for liking the thought, as if seeing myself on a screen. The market is closing, today I'm invisible, yesterday you cut your hair. Danger is cheating, managing panic. It's like trying not to drown in the air. You could breathe anywhere, whenever you wanted. You could be anywhere now, silent, unseen. Still breathing. You laughed when I said I hoped history would tell. Even in there they have air. You said, why would you care? They could all go to hell. That's when I knew what you meant. You said silence and shame had made you complete. I don't write. I can't speak. There are boys in the trees, with cages and whistles for birds. The window is dark now. The cats are away. I have heard nothing. There are no words. I will take to the streets in the morning. Tomorrow I take to the streets. So I drive around a lot, I do sort of domiciliary care work, and I'm driving around villages all over the place and in Hastings and around. And I see lots of things around me, the remnants of castles and the remnants of, you know, forts. And the only thing that's left on the landscape is the symbols of oppression. All the sort of babies that have been born and all the love that's been there, there's no trace of it. So we sort of like silt up with patriarchy and kind of violence. And I was in Greenwich, just watching these people walk in, sort of learning what Greenwich meant. And it's just a great bloody sort of temple for colonialism and slavery and war, isn't it? So yeah, I've written a funny poem about it. It's actually not funny, but so it's called Heritage at Bodiam Castle and Greenwich Palace. It's in parts again, I don't know. Gives me a chance to break and have a glass of wine. One, Bodiam Castle. Castles, gallows, forts and chapels, churches towering power and glory, palaces and stately homes and fields of bones and sites of battles celebrate genocide. The murdering of generations, the hedgerows and the country lanes, and through the trees, the crenellations, like shackles on the hillside, high on heritage and bullshit and the twisted lies of history. Down the tall tales, twisting misty, down the dark and hilly hollows, where the bitter moonshine that the proud fool has to swallow to wash away the taste of shame and call it pride, flows in streams of broken dreams from barrels labelled mad, bad, foolish, furious and starry-eyed, fills our guts with fire together in the gathering, to rage as bold as heroes in the night, holding to each other's arms and sing, our day will come when nobody will ever have to live like this. And yet every morning, turn that spring of hope into a stream of piss. We celebrate brutality, we preserve it for posterity as heritage and history. We let it flood our landscapes in its blinding light so that future generations may see their exploitation as inevitable, perpetual, and right. To Greenwich Palace. Idling neutral on the gravel of the car parks entrusted to the nation at Bodiam Castle and at Greenwich Palace, national patronage, culture demonstrated in a natural, harmonious power plan. You can read this in the papers. They teach it in your schools. It's what the tour guide said. You will have your own examples. You'll have heard the same before, repeated and repeated whenever power is spread. Lady Emma Hamilton dazzles from banners of pavilions, looks down, red lips, flags flying, flapping in the thin meridian mist. Over international guidelines, young minds penned in resident-only spaces, unauthorised use, £200 fine. Take the next left, past celebrity sex and death on the A206, telling the story, the only story, nation and glory holding the line, cruising past colonnades, sermons in stones, lessons in bricks, fame, power, manpower, slave-powered state power, cocking around all over the world now, setting the scene. We're here to be told what all of it means. It's Greenwich tea time. They come in queues, in backpacks, rain mats, badges, and practical shoes. Young and old, students, compliant and silent in lines, constantly counted, families gathered in piglets and pearls, and all with open hearts and open minds, from every corner of the cash-converted world, keen to learn, humble students, humble as we all should be, if our lessons were to love the lies of tyranny. Repeat after me, wherever you live, there is no alternative. Three, the tower. Now as I grow old and bold, and my blood boils warmer, and my heart grows cold to the infantile attraction of nostalgia and tradition that deluded me when I was young, all I see in those painted ceilings, those pillars and your statues is, what the fuck have you done? What the fuck have you done? As I stand here on my feet, breathing the love of you and all of us here in this room, me as a man, husband, father, here in older middle age, no shit, no shame, only rage and blame and a sense of responsibility. Me, if I had the hands, if I had the power, I would take every stone of every fort, every palace, every prison, every border wall, every castle, every court, Windsor and the Tower of London in particular, of course, but all of them, each and every one of them, I should grind their stones to dust, leave no trace, leave their shackles and their chains to rust. They have nothing left to teach us. They have taught us all we know, and all we know is all they taught. It's the last bit now. I'm sorry, that's enough. No more words about hate. For despite the genocide, the slavery, the patriarchal state, we have always, 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 almost always found the time for singing, dancing, laughter, and falling in love again. With the sun on my fat, shiny tummy, I am happy. You are smiling, and I will live forever by your side, in your arms, and you in mine. You loved me like a brother, and you chose me when you chose to be a bride. We sometimes spit sharp flecks and bridle with pride. Before laughing at our foolishness, we fix our hurts with kisses, dancing careful while our mud-dappled, milk-lipped babies sleep and snore like kittens with their cousins in the kitchen, and no mother's milk is ever took for gore. We never need to be perfect, but this is who we are and all we ought to be, no less, no more. Castles, palaces, and forts cast shadows, lying long and dark across the surface of the world. Their echoes running deep down through the years fracture our whole, divide each of us from one another, and even split us from our own selves apart. But who we really are, and everything our world can be is always here in you, in me, is always here, a new world in our hearts.